Victims of Communism lecture series, of which this is the second. I just want to say something about that. Most of you who are students have learned about the genocide of the Indians, slavery, the Holocaust, but most of you are not familiar with or really don't study other atrocities that have occurred, especially in modern history, the Ukrainian forced famine, collectivization in the Soviet Union and China, the secret police in those countries in which millions of people were killed. And then the other victims, people whose lives and ambitions and hopes and freedoms were taken away for decades and still today. And I think there's a tendency, especially people who share maybe some of the ideals of communism, not to want to talk about the atrocities, which I don't think are accidental. That's my view. They're part and parcel of the communist ideology. But be that as it may, I think it's important that we study it and that we discuss it. And today, we have a guest who really has lived through the consequences of this, and as a young person, a person younger than you. And you'll hear about her experiences, her husband is here, and she's selling her book, which I've read, which I really recommend. I've rarely read a more honest and moving account of suffering, and I really think it's worth reading. And also, I have a sheet there if you're interested in these series. You can sign, leave your name, and I'll start an email list. I wanted to say something about Chani. She survived this genocide, and you'll hear about that. But came to America as a refugee, didn't speak a word of English. She had ended schooling in the sixth grade for 4 years, obviously. There was no schooling in this tragedy, and came here and went into the 10th grade in Lincoln, Nebraska. Didn't speak any English, graduated from high school, went to the University of Nebraska at Lincoln, got a BS, came out here to Santa Clara, got an MA, has worked in the computer industry and the defense industry, and now has her own business. And I want to say that beyond her experiences, which are very real and very moving, I find Chani a remarkably inspirational person. And it's really my pleasure and my honor to introduce her. So I'm going to turn over to Chani Achebe. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Roth. It is a privilege for me to be here today to share with you my personal story of how my family and I struggled to survive the Cambodian genocide. So, Cambodia is a small country about the size of Missouri State. It is part of Southeast Asia. In 1970, after the Vietnam War spilled over to Cambodia, there's a guerrilla troop called themselves Khmer Rouge, rose against the government. And the Khmer Rouge was backed by Communist China. And the government in power at the time was backed by Americans. So they carry on wars and bloodshed for 5 years. And right after the American withdrawal from Southeast Asia, the Khmer Rouge took over the country. And what they did for the following 4 years is the crime against humanity. They killed an estimate of 2 million Cambodians. So these Cambodians died from starvation, execution, disease, or from purely exhaustion. Since I've been going around sharing my story, I realized that not many of people realize, know about the Cambodian genocide. And even fewer people realize that the Khmer Rouge was the communist regime. And the word Khmer Rouge means red flag. So many times we talk about, you know, Khmer Rouge commit the atrocity, commit the crime. We think of them like a random group of thugs going around killing without agenda. It's true that they are thugs, but their action was very intentional and deliberate. It was their way of controlling opposition through killing without mercy. So you can see that the Khmer Rouge leader, Pol Pot, he's, you know, highlighted in the front. His there's clear inspiration for the Khmer Rouge was the ideology of associating with the communist ideology. You can also see in the background the image of Karl Marx and the communist symbol of hammer and sickle. So they believe that capitalism is a cause of human inequality and suffering. The very first thing they did to control any opposition was to collect all the former regime soldier and confiscated their guns. The other thing they did was to eliminate capitalism, what they believe to be evil, is to decide to run the country without currency. So they closed school, banks and market, hospital, even place of worship, and moved the people from cities, small towns, and villages to countryside, remote countryside, and where they forced us to work in a horrible working condition without hardly anything to eat. And on top of that, they destroy all the farm equipment because they believe that those are the symbol and sign of capitalism, which they fight to eliminate. And they will target anybody who had made a living before they took over. Those people that make a living without putting in physical labor are considered to be corrupted and lazy. So they would target not only the educated and intellectual, but also businessmen, the monk and priest alike, because those people did not put, you know, labor and sweat into what they're doing for a living. So my father was a businessman. But he didn't start off with rich and comfortable home, because his father, my grandfather, was also a refugee escaping communist China. So when my father was a very young age, he never had an opportunity to go to school. In fact, neither of my parents had the opportunity to spend a day at school. They spent their young age helping the family put food on the table. But they work hard. They work hard because they want their children to have what they didn't have. They want to, you know, build a strong family. And all of that taken away from them forcefully by the communist Cambodian because of the sake being equality and sharing law. So a couple weeks actually before the communists took over, we were escaping from our hometown to near the border, so if there's any chance we might flee the country if it got really bad. But I remember my father was talking to his friend while he trying to decide if he should stay in the country or flee the country. And his word was, he said, if the red win the war, Cambodia will turn into communist country for sure. But at the same time, he was confident that no matter what happened, Cambodia will not be as bad as in China, which his, you know, father told him all the bad story that you know, he had gone through. Because communist, in my father's view, because Cambodian, in my father's view, was a country that is self-sufficient, a bountiful country. There's nobody in the country, doesn't matter how poor you are, there's always food for everybody. We even have excess food to export. So with that kind of mentality, he decided to wait it out. So when the communists took over, I was 13 years old, and this is my family. I have two brothers and one sister. And my younger brother never made it. We don't have anything about him to look at, but also only the memory. So I remember the very first day, the very next day when they took over, I woke up with gunfire, yelling and screaming, chaos in the air. They demand the soldier, the Khmer Rouge soldier, I call him the black uniform because they dress all black, and they would come in with gunpoint and chase us out of our house. It would be like a thief coming into your house, and they don't just rob your belonging and your precious sentimental value, but they take everything, your house, your life that you have built, and they chase us out of the house. Within 5 minutes, we were in front of our house with everybody else in the whole village in the street, marching away from the city, marching away from our home. So on that very first day, many kids was, you know, separated from their family. Mom was crying frantically, looking for their baby, but nobody can help anybody. But all we got was the gun behind us. Keep going, keep going. And there's right there, on that same morning, some family didn't even have food. So right off the bat, they experienced hunger. My family was lucky because my mother make us go through emergency drill every night before we go to bed. And in this very first day when we walk out of our home on that highway, the only highway that came out from that town, there's people that dying along the side and left dying like an animal. And that very first day, it was the longest day I ever walked in my life. We go from town to town, keep walking. That, you know, town that I didn't even know of exists because it just drove by. By nighttime, people was laying down along the highways. You know, we would be rescued by a complete stranger. She took us in, gave us water and food. Her house was full of people. And that night, I remember my leg was like so sore. I keep waking up because the muscle of my calf keep turning and twisting. It's like it was ripping from the back of my leg and trying to rest it on top of my shin. But it was an awful experience, only to wake up the same, you know, in that morning, just the sound that I'm familiar from the morning before. And they basically tell us to move again. Even in this small town that we got to, have to move from that small town to further, you know, to a more remote area. I felt like before they chased us out from our house and from our comfort zone, now they chased us out of civilization. When you step away from the asphalt highway, that was the first time you felt like, will you ever get back? But then we go into this small village. It was more like a commune, it's not really a village, because there's only like a few huts. And everything there was so different, even the sound of the environment around it, I'm not used to. The cricket, the birds that I never heard before. And then we get into this village, everybody looked different. You know, people there look completely different from us. They dress different, they talk different, they act different. So it was clear that, you know, how our way of life is completely different than them, and our values are different from them. They didn't want us there, and we didn't want to be there, but we got stuck there. And everything about that town was so backward. There's no running water. There's not even an outhouse. And there was nothing in the town beside town and people. Everywhere you want to go, there's no motorcycle, there's no street. Everywhere they want to go is within walking distance, not even a horse, because everywhere they want to go, it's just walking distance. So we were in this remote town with a whole bunch of city folks and the village people who didn't want us there. But the reason I said that, you know, maybe some of you said, well, that still happens around in the world these days. But what happened there for me was like 2 days ago, I was in the city, just like you guys are today, running water, electricity, sleeping in my bed 2 nights ago. Now I'm, at that time, now I'm under somebody else's hut. They got a bamboo and thatch. It was so shocking to us. And within weeks, my family moved from two-story brick house to a hut that we built with our old family. This is a hut about the size of three queen-size beds put together and make out of thatch and the grass roof and grass wall, third floor and a bamboo rack to rest to sleep on. But it's a special place for me. It's a special place to every one of us alive. Because it was a place that we prayed together, that we encouraged each other to not give up. And it's the last place that we were together as a family. Also, it's in this place that we experienced our first starvation. You know, I don't know how many of you have been through starvation, but you wake up exhausted because you're tired, you didn't have food days before, and your stomach just kind of cramped, and the cramp from starvation, I would have to say it's worse than any cramp that I ever experienced. It felt like the stomach is ingested itself. Even in that condition that we're all in, we don't have a choice but to step out from this shelter into the monsoon rain, a relentless cold without any protection, because we were city folk. We didn't prepare for all this element. We didn't expect to be in the rain, in the water, you know, at least 12 hours a day working without any food, any break. And only to come home with 1 tablespoon of rice per person per day. That was our ration. I remember I eat anything that moved, and many things that I wish I forget. There's many people die from starvation around us and sick. First it was the elderly, then it was the loved one. And my experience with that, the worst part was being in the sick house. I call it the sick house because if you can't work, they put you into the hospital, they call it. But to me, it's a sick house because you don't get out until you can work again. But in that sick house, there's no treatment. You just stay there until maybe your body recover and you'll be back to work with everybody. And when you're in the sick house, your ration is less than people that's working because you're useless to the government. And in that sick house, I listened to people who's dying. I remember I was 13 years old. Imagine yourself being 13 years old and you're being in this place with a lot of sick and people are dying and you know that they're not gonna make it by the way they look. And when they finally can no longer feel the pain, you feel relief because they no longer have to suffer. But then, as soon as I know that somebody is dying, I fear, because I was just a little girl, that I would be sleeping with the poor in the same room with me, which happened a lot. because my roots will come up only once a day to collect the dirt. And many of my friends, my family's friends, evacuated from the city. Many of them was dumped in the field, in the middle of the field, nowhere. I'm not talking about town, I'm talking about field. Not even a remote village, but field, complete open. And there was no ration for them. And as most of them are gone, and a few of them, you know, venture out to where we at. And one time I saw our friend, we couldn't recognize her because she looked completely different only a couple months before. The only reason we recognized her was her voice. But we were lucky because we got 1 tablespoon of rice per person per day. In her case, the ration stopped months ago. They didn't care. Not even the Khmer Rouge was near them because they didn't care. They were left to die. So our ration was given by a former peasant, which then they become our leader. And the way they gave us ration, because of the way we looked and what we were, they despised us for what we, you know, doing for a living before the communists took over. It was not fair. You know, they had like 1 cup of rice for family, and by the time that rice got to my bucket, it tilt and fall along the way. But when it's there, it's all full, heat full. But you can't complain about it. And everything was turning upside down. You know, the peasant becomes the boss, and the boss becomes the slave. But everybody was in worse situation than before the communists took over, because everybody was starving. The very idea that the communists was fighting for, equality and suffering, was still there. But only, you know, a few of them that was okay. The rest of us, peasant or master alike, was starving. So when I read the story in the book about Animal Farm, I keep thinking about that time. I don't know. Have any of you heard about this before? So at first, the peasant was feeling good because, you know, they see that their role is switching. Maybe they've been dying to be the boss a long time. Now it just happened. They got to be the boss and we got to, you know, working for them. But then even the peasants start to complain about the situation. You know, you hear things like they said, well, even, you know, my old master would have given me at least a pair of new clothes a year. That's how bad it was. There's no new clothes. If you didn't have anything by the time 4 years later, I wear the same clothes and I keep patch on patch, and my patch is too thick, and then it tore the fabric that I was trying to patch. It's nothing. The other thing the black uniform did was they allocate work for us. They said that if you finish working on this field for person, you can go home. And sure enough, you know, the peasant and the farm worker that already familiar with this kind of work, they got home really quick, you know, early afternoon they were heading home. And for us city folks, putting long hours until we got it done, and then late in the day, we got to go home. And then after a few days later, the black uniform gave another rule. It's almost like they adjust based on the feel like, right? They said, well, it's not fair because you guys got to go home before this newcomer. So when you finish, you help this newcomer. Well, sure enough, you know, it was amazing how slow they were, the farmer and the peasant. So it didn't make any sense to me, even at the young age. You know, they accused my father and people like my father as a crook, exploiting the labor of others. And then at the same time, they take the incentive away from the people who's actually putting the work that they're counting on to make the country prosper. So, oh, I forgot to tell you that while I was, you know, you think about the hard labor, the starvation, and taking away what you have, you know, moving from your comfort home to all this place, you thought that was the worst. But the worst part for me was when they trying to break up the family structure. They took away all the children from the parents. You know, they would tell us, young children anyway, they said, your parents cannot provide for you. We are the one, the government provide for you. So the government owned everything. The government owned everyone. So when they come to take my sibling, my older sibling away, I thought for sure that I was spared because I was too young to be away from my parents. But that's not true, they came to get me. And by the time they came to get me, I was in the field working, and when they call out to me, it felt like I was being hypnotized. No resistance, no plea, no begging to, you know, do whatever to please them to stay closer to my parents. Because they won't listen to you, or in fact, you're supposed to be happy because they rescue you from the old corrupted regime, your parents. So when I walk behind them, I try to look at my father. He was working in the field. I try to communicate to him. I try to have him look at me for the last time because I don't know where I'm going to go. I don't know when I will see him again. I was desperate, agonizing, but quietly pleading for my father to look at me. But he didn't look at me. It was too painful for him to witness this separation. He keep working like it's nothing happened. He did not want to admit that they take his kid away from him. So when I walk back to the hut that we, you know, stay together, I realize there's nobody there. My young brother, who was 9 years old at the time, he was also working in the field caring for the animal. So he wasn't there. And my mother was in the sick house. So I went to the hut and grabbed a plate and a spoon and an extra clothes and tied at the end of my scarf and ran to see my mother. And my mother was in the sick house. When she saw me, she knew what's going on, but she didn't cry. And being 13 years old, I was desperate. I wanted her to cry for me. I wonder why she didn't cry. I wanted her blessing, but she didn't. All she did was to rub the dry mud on my forearm and said, you'll be all right. So I walk away from my family, I walk away from the security of my mother, not knowing when I will ever see them again. So all these young kids, 13, 14 years old, walk behind the black uniform and gun to the labor camp. And in the labor camp, it's just a thatch with roof, grass roof, open wall. There's no wall, just a grass roof to protect it from the sun. And on dirt floor, we stay there. There's no wall, there's no fence, there's no barbed wire. It's just the way they control us is to fear, break us from people that we trust. That's how they control us. The whole country is turned into like a labor camp. So it's almost like the Khmer Rouge take revenge of anybody who didn't fight alongside with them. So anybody, they treat us like an enemy. So many times I remember the first few months when I was working before it got really bad, I said, there's no way that, you know, the world would let us be like this. Somebody's going to have to help and come rescue us, right? Maybe the American. Maybe the lucky Cambodian who had escaped the country before they took over. They're going to come and campaign and get people to come and back and help us. Because what the Khmer Rouge do to the whole country was, it's inhumane. But then I lost hope because weeks after weeks, for 6 months, I go like this without, you know, any food and with a heartbroken condition. For me, the hardest part is not about the feeling of hunger, but to remember how my family suffered, especially those that are not with, here with us today, those who did not survive. So in that labor camp is when I see the first fat black uniform. It's like everybody was starving. We couldn't hardly walk, and this guy come up with the belly stick farther than his nose, and he tell us to call him father. Because to them, family doesn't matter, has no value. Everybody should be thinking about only, everybody was equal. The equality is not just economic, it's fall into the structure of the family. So a kid has the same right as the parent. And in fact, some parents are afraid that if they do something, the kid might just turn them into the black uniform. So the fact that, you know, my parent or your parent, the individuality, it doesn't matter anymore. In fact, anybody is older than you is supposed to be your father. And so they break this bond, this security, this trust between family and friends. And it was in this place that the family doesn't matter, it's just government and people. And the love that you're supposed to express, the old song that you're talking about, the old regime love song or band, the only love that you should express is between you and the government. And in this picture, it shows that how they force marriage. And you don't know. You stand up in line with the camp, young girl camp and the young boy camp. And then in this meeting, they would pair them up, force marriage. So it was in this very first camp that I learned keeping our hair long, touch our shoulder is a crime. So if you ever go on the internet and try to search for the Khmer Rouge victim, all the girls have their hair cut, and that's why. It was the law of the land. So, when I put this picture together, I have a mixed feeling of, well, I just expect them to put them up here. But I decided that it's more important for you guys to see this. And I can feel their fear when I look at them. Because they are about the same age as I was when the communists took over. And their only crime is to born in the family that the Khmer Rouge did not like. So why is it important, this short hair law? It's because, you know, with all the starvation, with all the hard labor, with all the things that they have done to us and break us up from our family, what does it matter, you know, the length of your hair? Why does it bother me so much? It bothered me because I felt like, what else are they going to do? You know, they take away everything we had, even the length of our hair. It's their way of humiliating us, to break us. To say, you can't control anything. You belong to us. We can do whatever you want. And for me at the time, you know, all the things that I've gone through that was so terrible, I couldn't even believe myself that having, you know, my hair cut, it could impact me. Because I saw my friend was lined up and the lady sitting on the stump and cutting their hair. It was devastating to even see. And the scissor was made out of cast iron. and you can see those girls, you know, twitching and all that. But it's not the length of the hair, it's the freedom. It's you can't do anything to yourself. Everything about you is owned by the government. But at the same time, you know, in my case, I felt like this is a mistake for them because I never cut my hair because my hair was already short before I got in. And this is my hair 2 months before the communists took over. So I never gave them the satisfaction to cut my hair because I spent 4 years in the communists, my hair never grew. It never grew. I came back 4 years later, have my freedom. It's the same length of hair I get in. Malnutrition. It's also this small victory for me personally that made me strong. A little thing like, I remember reflecting on the fact that I never cried when I starved, when I was sick. And even if I cry only when they break me from my family. I cry only when people look at me and, you know, do kind things to me, have compassion for me. I never cry because they inflicted pain on me. And that reflection gave me kind of dignity that they could not take away from me. That they didn't win because I didn't cry when I was starving. I didn't cry when they hurt me. The other thing that made me feel strong and survive all this was my mother. I remember many times that I felt like I had enough. I just want to refuse the ration and just finish the suffering. But then I thought of my mother. The image of how she would react and how painful it is for her to lose the child. And I say to myself, not yet. Not until your mother have a chance to hold you because she deserved that much. Don't let the communists take that away from her. And that was my way of fighting and keep living for her. My best hope many times was to dream that I died in her car. That was a peace that I was dying for. And that's why I keep going and living under the communism. So before they took all of us away from my parents, my dad told us that any one of us, if we have a chance to leave the country, leave. Don't even think about what my father would think, what my mother would think, what my brother would miss me. Just leave. And he also said, dying is better than living like this. So a year after the communists took over, my two brothers was in the labor camp. They got a chance to leave the country, and they did in 1976. And then in 1978, my father and my younger brother left. So it was just me, my sister, and my mother. 1 year after my dad left, we finally got free because the Cambodian, the Khmer Rouge was ousted by the communist Vietnamese. So in that time, when the Vietnamese took over, we were running to the bomb. You know, this is why every time I heard the American song, the American national anthem, you know, the bomb busting, how do you say it?
Busting,
yeah. The bomb busting. It gave you freedom. It made you feel free. Somebody cared. Somebody fighting for you. That's how I felt. We were running to the bomb. And only to stay in the Vietnamese for about 2 months because we didn't have anything. And there was no government, not even the ration, from the Khmer Rouge would help us. So we can get, because we didn't have any saving left. All the jewelry my mom was exchanged under the black uniform, black market. We didn't have anything left. So the three of us would go as close as we can to the Khmer Rouge side and to collect rice so that we can exchange rice to come back, you know, make a living that way. But it was okay because it was free. But then, because we get so close, the Khmer Rouge come and take us again. So we got a taste of 2 months of freedom and back in the Khmer Rouge again. And we were in the jungle working for them. But it was the mentality of dying is better than living, like that. So we struggled to, you know, we gave courage, my sister and my mom and I, to escape again. So we escaped the Khmer Rouge again. And this time our goal was to be together as much as we can. We don't know how we're gonna survive, but at least be together. The idea is dying together and living together. And that's what the three of us have. And when we finally, because, you know, think about it from my mom's perspective, a lady with two teenagers in a country that lawless, has no government, has no rations, has no structure of any kind. And it was a man world in that time. So what my mom had to go through to, you know, hustle both of us back and forth in between this area. And finally we escaped Cambodia. The very first time was we almost got killed because we ran out of water and we got lost in the jungle. And just to give you the how bad it was, half the people, like 15 people died from that. And I was drinking my own urine because we didn't have any water and we heard that, you know, this is the way to survive. So we finally decided, instead of moving forward through the jungle and hope to get to Thailand, is to go back, because we know that if we go back, we have water. And when we go back, we got taken into Vietnamese jail. And even like this talking about 2 month period, it was, I can't stay here, we can't stay here, it doesn't matter what happened, we have to go. So after 1 week in the Vietnamese jail and my body was still have rash from, you know, being rolling around in the jungle with that water, I still have mark and rash and infection. My mom took us out again and escaped again. And this time we made it to Thailand. And I got to Lincoln, Nebraska in June 1979. So, I think it's about running out of time. So, what I want to share with you is that two generations of my family have deeply scarred by communism. My grandfather with the communist China, and my family with the Khmer Rouge communist Cambodia. My father and my younger brother did not survive. But it is the memory that bring me here and give me strength. Brave enough to talk in front of you guys publicly about how I felt about communism. It's not how I felt, it's about what it was. To share my story and my father's and my little brother's story and many people who died that way. Because I believe that only through knowing will you be able to make a decision and help make a better place, make a more peaceful world. So I hope that you remember our time together and that you ask yourself, maybe, you know, ask the question, how do you see yourself? Are you the have or have not? And what should you do if you are the have, right? How can you help others? Think of ways to help others. You don't need anybody or any government to tell you what to do with what you have. And if you have not, What can you do to improve yourself? I speak from experience. I didn't have anything when I came here. I'm grateful for this country. And the communists destroyed my family. The Americans gave me hope. So with that, I think that we can't change anything tomorrow, but we can improve our future one day at a time. And I'm grateful for your time, and thank you for being here.
Okay, I think we have time for some questions. Especially, Brandon.
How do you feel about the current Cambodian government and how the prime minister has been in power since like 1985 and that they're getting more funding from China and kind of being built up by communist China again?
Not very good. I think that, like anything that we live in, if we are not independent, where will we take the money from? We're a slave to that.
Here.
You mentioned that your father or your grandfather came from China. To what extent was the fact that you were, I presume, not ethnic Cambodian, how did that influence your being subjected to this?
Well, if you read the detail of how I feel, it's very, very much against my color, mm-hmm. because I'm known as a white skin. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot to everything I do. But then there's also a group of white skin that I can identify myself to. But on top of it, it was always my mom. And my mom would always be the one who, even before I experienced all this discrimination, she's the one, my cornerstone, the one that always tell me that I'm better than anybody. So I think that alone made me strong. Every time I face discrimination, I honestly felt like, oh, I'm better than you. So it really helped a lot, so. And even now, right? It's almost like all my life, even before the communists took over, I'm being picked up because I'm different. I'm being picked up by both groups because the Chinese family said, she's not Chinese because she doesn't speak Chinese. And the Cambodian family said, well, she's not Cambodian, look at her. So,
any other questions from the young people? Yes.
I have a comment to make. You're a very strong woman.
Thank you.
In the back there?
Was it difficult adjusting after coming out of the Cambodian government and being
forced
to leave?
It was like freedom, and it was like second chance of life. It's the opposite feeling of being taken away from home and putting into remote, and the next day your life's changing upside down. So it's not the opposite. The next day my life changing upside down. Only like 2 months ago I was in the jungle. I don't need shoes because my sole was so thick that I can walk on anything that it, the guilt that you're talking about, it does happen eventually, but not at first. I think about what happened to my young brother. I felt many years, even now, when I put it in my book, I felt a little bit relieved, but still felt responsible. Because he came to me and he said he didn't want to go. And my father wanted to take him with him. He came to me, confessed to me, he said that he's scared. And what did I do? I told him, are you crazy? I wish Dad take me, right? But now when I think about it, that comment is very selfish because I didn't listen to him. I was thinking about me and how my dad didn't pick me. If I was to listen to him, I would say, go run away, hide. Dad cannot find you and you can't go. So for many years, I remember that. So, go back to what you're saying, I have dreamed about it. but the dream is less, more or less impact, less frequent.
Yeah, in the back.
You're obviously feel grateful in this country for the opportunities that they gave you. How do you feel about the way our country is attacking itself in a way right now? And what would you say to us to feel better about our country?
You know, I hear that and I do get scared from my experience, right? But I hear a similar rhetoric. For example, income inequality or sharing wealth. I heard this before. For example, what is it called? But 6 years ago, like
Occupy Wall Street.
So right before the communists took over, there was similar thing happened in my hometown. And being like 13 years old, I thought, you know, the same thing happened. Like, they think that the businessmen are crooks, and they, you know, all the things that I was trying to explain to you in the presentation. But being 13 years old at the time, I felt that they were right. That my father, I can see that. My father did not spend a day in the farm. My father didn't sweat. Maybe these people are right. I read about it, I heard about it, and feeling guilty that I'm benefiting from that. But it's all wrong, you know, it's all wrong at the end. So yeah, I do feel that. And for that matter, I'm taking a chance to be here with you guys because it's that important, it's that scary.
Yeah, in the back.
Based off of your experiences, other than like the possibly obvious, in both countries, Vietnam and here, as a citizen, what would you like from a government or a leadership to better serve you as a citizen?
What do I like?
What would you want the government to do for you as an American citizen?
What would you want to see from leadership?
I think the help that I want, that I would like the government have is to protect the country, for one thing. And the second thing is to help make each one of us strong. Not give us things, because if they give us, they own us. How do they make us strong? Through education, encouragement, share a dream, tell you what you can do, not to put you down by thinking that, you know, you may not be strong enough.
I'd like the students especially, you know, your feelings or reactions or questions. This is a remarkable opportunity, I think, to meet someone like Jen. Yeah.
So obviously, you've made such a successful life after, you know, this tragedy with your book and your business now. What did you do, what were some of the first things you did when you got to America, you know, start this journey?
I remember by the time I left Thailand and on my flight to America, I have no idea what America looked like or feel like or smell like, you know. It's not like now you can see America through internet and things like that. I have no clue. I don't know the language or anything. And I have a lot of fear. Fear about what I'm gonna do in this country. Fear that maybe I'm a burden to this new country that I'm gonna be part of. Because there's no way that I'm gonna go back there. This is my new country. And I thought about being maybe, you know, being, I thought logically how I could do, you know, so that I'm not a burden to the people that I'm going into. And my dream was to, my plan was to clean people's house, because I know how to do that, right? Clean people's house, save money so I can have enough money to do what most younger want to do, working at the beauty shop, and then own my shop so my mom never had to work again. But when I got here, I did clean people's house. My first job was cleaning high school yard. I cleaned office, I waitress, I was a busboy, I worked in the public garden, you know, all sort of stuff. But there's one day at a time, you know, one day at a time of doing my homework. I didn't think that, you know, going to school was a good idea because, you know, I didn't go to school 4 years before, and even in my old language, even math and stuff is rusty. But I just do what they told me. And my mom wanted me to go to school, and you know, I have ESL teacher. Are you guys familiar with ESL teacher? My ESL teacher was like my mentor, my counselor, and my sponsor to this country. She teach me, you know, from 8 to 5, because I didn't know any English. She didn't know any Cambodian. She was my Miss Solomon in
Helen Keller.
And you know, I hope, you know, when I look at myself and what I've done as necessary to make a better life for my children, but when I look back and talking to people, I wanted to, my goal is to go back and share the experience with the new immigrant and refugee. It doesn't matter how they get here, but when they're here, they should be welcome so that, you know, we can make a better American.
Anybody else? Yeah, here.
So these atrocities came at the hand of Pol Pot and his like regime, similar to the way that atrocities that the Nazis perpetrated at the hand of Hitler and his regime, yeah, and also the Soviets. So do you think, have you found it in your heart to forgive the soldiers in the black uniforms? Not the regime, but the people pulling the trigger?
I actually, it's like, what do I forgive? There's nobody exists for me to forgive. They all gone, or they assimilated to, you know, to the growing country now. It's just a story.
So there's no contempt there?
There's no contempt.
That's beautiful.
Remarkable.
But we don't want it to happen again. What do I contempt you? Seriously, you know?
Beautiful. Question here?
Well, because I have nothing, when I came here, I had nothing with me. Right? I have nothing with me. I have nothing to pitch in. I wasn't an engineer. I didn't know anything, you know.
Before we go on, it's 1 o'clock, so I know some of you have to go. So why don't you go, and then those who want to stay, are you willing to stay?
Yeah.
So thank you all.
Thank
appreciate
you.
It. Thank you.